I'm really happy to be back on Razmafsar TV, and I'm having Bede here. Hi Bede, how are you today?
I'm doing quite well, thank you.
Okay, Bede, we are going to talk about another manuscript, archery manuscript we worked on together, and it is a very specific one, very detailed one, and our Persian Archery Manual by Mohammad Zamān. I mean, this guy has a very long name, Mohammad Zamān, who was known as Čerāq Beg from the family of Kāmrān Beg Qarānāj. I mean, what a name. Yeah. Wow. Okay.
Well, what I think we've got here is that a lot of Persians migrated to Mughal India.
Yeah.
And they were very proud of their origin.
Yeah.
At the end of it, they give a year, which is 1191, which translates to 1771, 1772. Which is the year it was probably copied, or maybe then there's another one about 25 years later,
yeah,
which is probably when it was put into the library of somebody called Aurangzeb Shirazi. See, another Persian name. you actually did some research on him because I remember reading it. This is an interestingly organized manuscript in that it's organized into 12 chapters, and there's a massive appendix at the end discussing errors and things like that. It also has a lot more technical detail than some of the manuals.
Yeah.
And there are things in this that match some other manuals, as particularly talking about which fingers you tighten, which suggests to me that there is something wrong with the way some original source had been copied. Because if you look at the overview, it says exactly what we'd expect. But if you look at the detail, it's got fingers loose that should be tight and fingers tight that should be loose. And I don't think they would make mistakes like that. So my guess is it's an error in an original source that this person used and a couple of the other authors were used. They would be going from, they're quoting other authorities, and they're probably quoting out of somebody's library that they've had a scribe copy down for them. But the thing that's really important about this one is the level of detail about things that bow makers, arrow makers, and archers would want to know.
Yeah.
And not just at the time it was written, but us as well. It's got a lot of detail, and it's got some really, we don't know when it was written, but we know when it was copied. And remember, Saracen archery was written in the 1290s, but it was copied in 1500, so that the copy that was translated into English is actually 210 years younger than the original.
Yeah.
And we've got, just because something has a date on it doesn't necessarily mean, you know, this is what they're talking about. The thing about this is there's no mention of firearms at all in it.
Yeah.
And that kind of suggests to me that it's probably one of the older ones, because firearms, like in battle and that, were quite common both in Iran and in Mughal India.
Yeah.
So, you know, it might be based on an earlier one. It might be a cleanup. It could be he's had something that's had mixed information in it and just selected out the archery stuff and made it all pure and clear and whatever. We don't know. But let's start off with the first chapter, which is about the thumb, training bows, and something that we have no idea what it means, lace.
Yeah.
We don't know what this word means. We know it's a type of shooting. It's probably a type of target shooting.
Yeah.
There's enough circumstantial evidence to give us that feeling. However, having said that, that's about all we do know. I'm just going to open the original up so that if I need to, I can. Because we made this, as this was published, it has very extensive footnotes. As you always do when you do a translation, all special Farsi words that may have a technical meaning always get written out in full in Farsi with a Latin alphabet equivalent, and where there is a reference to it in yeah. one of the big dictionaries, that's there yeah. too. So this means that if someone reads this article, there's going to be a lot more than we're talking about today, yeah. Because of all that extra information. So the first sentence of the chapter is, first, the bow should have short arms and its horn should be sawn and made with the width of two fingers so that it will be very soft. Two fingers, which is about roughly 40 millimeters.
Yeah.
Which is not a bad size, Turkish bow size, Chahaham bow size.
Yeah.
But he says so that it is very soft. Now, soft is a relative term.
Yeah, of course.
I think these guys, when they're talking about hard, they're talking about something where, because you just have to look at the ranges they're talking about. They're not soft bows by our terminology. They're very stiff. They hold this bow, stand it up in a way that the right leg is behind and the left leg is forward. This is that standard stance where you have your left foot pointing at the target, your right foot at right angles behind it. The left arm is extended like a column. With the right hand, he pulls the string to the mustache level so that it reaches the right earlobe. Now, a lot of people, when they read mustache draw, think you draw to the mustache. But all of the manuscripts where they talk about it in detail say you draw on the mustache back to the lobe of the ear.
Yeah.
Because they wanted long draws. And there's a, I don't know whether there's a part of the brain, the part of the human brain that developed to throw stones, but there's a part of the brain that doesn't require eye to point to aim. It just requires the body to be aligned.
Yeah.
And that's instinctive aiming, sometimes called. It's not, people don't always mean that when they use that term, but
yeah.
there is a basic human instinct for throwing stones, and it translates into certain ways of aiming in archery. So not all archery aiming is geometric. Sometimes it's just, you know where the arrow is going to go. There are four types of pulling the bow. We know these. They're in several of the other manuscripts.
Yeah.
The eyebrow draw, the mustache draw, the beard draw.
That's the new one, right? This yeah. manuscript mentions, right?
Yeah, exactly. And this is in other manuscripts in Arabic too, that where they talk about drawing along the side of the jaw, which is where the beard is.
They call it jaw then. Okay, that's
yeah, right. They call it the jaw. So and the side of the body draw, which is the chest draw.
I just want to say Sinekesh. That's the Sinekesh, and he calls it the side of the body. That's right. Okay.
Yeah. And I mean they are the basic draws.
Yeah.
But he says, but as the good things are in the middle way, they should act upon the teachings of the old masters and use the mustache draw. The aim is to draw to the earlobe and the hand should not drop. Otherwise, it would be called a beard draw. So you're drawing here, not there. It looks very small.
Yeah.
But from an aiming point of view, it is quite different. See, there's a thing where you're getting your... I don't fit in this. You're getting your elbow back into a position so that the forearm is pulling without being able to open up the upper arm. So it's pushing the upper arm into the shoulder joint. Yeah. And that's where you get a very strong draw. And this is, he wants that level because he believes that is the proper level to get the whole body, you know, left arm like a column, all this kind of stuff. It's to get this really strong draw. And if you look at old photographs from China where they're doing the really long draw with the Manchu bows, they actually always have that height. When you're looking at somebody who's really shooting, I'm not talking about when they get somebody to pose, but when you can physically see that they're actually drawing and shooting. It is also said that the training bow is necessary. They should draw this type of bow slowly, and it's not good to draw it fast. They should draw it so slowly as if they were removing a hair from dough. This is like bread making dough. They should keep three fingers of the hand grasping the bow handle tight, namely the thumb, the middle finger, and the ring finger. This does not make any sense for holding the bow. What they probably mean is they mean that you should keep these three fingers tight and the I don't know. This is repeated elsewhere, and it's certainly a quote from something. And maybe we'll find the original one and we'll find out that somehow I'm guessing that they really mean the middle finger, the ring finger, and the small finger, the little finger.
Can I be, if you're talking about the, okay, the bow grasp, right? The hand which is holding the bow. If I keep the thumb and the middle and the ring finger, then it's going to be like a Sasanitro grasp.
Yeah. Right? Yeah, except it's on the bow, where it's totally inappropriate. Yeah,
exactly.
I think that there may be a crossover here where something is coming out of an old manual and it's just got moved around. Yeah. There is no surviving painting from India or Iran or Turkey of someone holding a bow like that.
Yeah.
And the chances that this is something magical is very small. My guess is, since all other things say you keep these two fingers relaxed and these three fingers tight, that they've substituted thumb for little finger and it's happened a long time ago. Because he says the index finger and the small finger are kept loosely, but that's exactly what all the other manuals say you do with the thumb and the index finger.
Yeah.
So there's a swap around. And then he quotes a poem. Two are held tight, three loose, three tight and two loose. And again, if you're doing this, you've got four tight and one loose.
Yeah.
Three tight and two loose. So there's something mixed up here. But in the very first part, you get a valuable piece of information about the width of the horn on the bow, and then you get something that just doesn't make any sense because it contradicts itself later as well. But then he comes out with something that's really obvious and important. Each time the archer is stronger than the bow, he shoots better. Otherwise, he will not be able to show his skills. Don't get a bow that's too strong for you. This is so constant in all these manuals. And when you think about modern day experience of people going to bow shops and buying bows that are much too strong for them,
they do, yeah.
It's a basic human thing. We overestimate our capabilities because bows don't look that daunting. But after you've shot, 20 or 30 arrows with a bow that's 5 pounds heavier than you can handle, you're really quite tired and it's not very good. Then he goes on, again, we're going from generalization to something very focused. There are four types of thumb protectors. The first type of made from gold is strong. I've handled a couple of solid gold thumb rings and they're cast quite thick. So they actually are strong. They don't make thin gold thumb rings. They make thin bronze or brass ones that may be only a millimeter or a millimeter and a half thick.
Yeah.
But gold ones, everyone I've seen has been very thick. And in fact, most that I've seen have been inlaid with jewels, diamonds and things like that. Yeah. So that's a very interesting thing in itself. The second one that is made of patterned crucible steel. I've seen one ring like this, maybe two if I count one that's in a catalogue. I saw one in person, which was Memluk, and it actually had a cut across the back where it had been hit by a sword while its owner was wearing it. Steel rings work perfectly well as long as they're not made too chunky. And in a culture, and everywhere in the Middle East, knew about crucible steel and they knew how to make it beautiful. So therefore that would be a good thing. Third one is made of walrus ivory without black spots so that it's not brittle. I have a walrus ivory ring. There's lots of references to them as being Persian archery rings. They're really rather beautiful because the dentine of walrus ivory is like little cubes and shapes set into it, whilst the outside ivory is really shiny. There was a big trade in walrus ivory for centuries. If the Viking colony in Greenland was supported by exporting walrus ivory to Europe. So, I mean, you know, this is, it's got a special name in Persian too.
Shirmahi.
Yeah.
Shirmahi.
Yeah. I always get it mixed up with Shivani for some reason.
Yeah.
The fourth is made either of horn, either black or white. And if it's made of both colors, black and white, it looks better. I have one that is made of two layers. One layer is ivory and the layer below it is black buffalo horn. And then the ring is carved out through it.
Okay.
Yeah, there's one, a Turkish one, we think, in the Grayson collection in the University of Missouri, Columbia.
Are they glued to each other?
Yeah, it's just glued together. The glue joints are so thin they're invisible. It looks just like black and white.
Wow.
It looks like a solid thing made from black and white. Even after years where insects have gnawed a bit at the horn and that, you really don't see it as something separate. The bond is very, very solid. And bear in mind, it's taking a fair bit of pressure too. I've got some very nice camel bone and some black buffalo horn, and I was going to make one and just see how it performed.
I don't want to change the subject, but just because I have always wanted to ask you this. Do you have camels in Australia?
Oh, yeah. Lots.
Okay, okay. A lot. Okay. Yeah. I had never noticed that. Okay.
When Australia was being developed in the 19th century, we had a large area which didn't have any roads, didn't have much water, and had people every few hundred miles.
Whoa.
And so they imported Pashtun camel drivers. They called them Afghans. Some of them might have been from Afghanistan. Most were from what we would call Pakistan now. And camels. So there was a whole community of Pashtun-speaking camel drivers.
Interesting.
Going through Central Australia, delivering goods right up to the development of large internal combustion engine vehicles.
Wow.
And bearing in mind that a lot of the people living out there were British and Irish and Scottish, they really, really liked having Muslim camel drivers because they didn't steal the alcohol. They didn't trust their own people. So, but they're still, their descendants still live here. There are little mosques out in the middle of the desert. And the camels were let loose when it became no longer commercial to use them. So they went wild. There were no native parasites. There were no native animals that could kill them. So we export healthy camels back to Saudi Arabia.
That's really funny. Okay.
Yeah. It can actually, in you know, like game butchers, you can buy camel meat. Personally, didn't think it was that great, but that might have been wrong age camel or something like that. You never know.
And they're now walking in the nature there?
There's millions.
Wow.
Central Australia is covered in camels. You can go out and have camel rides.
They just walk around there and feed themselves. Okay, like in the US, these wild horses, right? Something like that, exactly. Right?
I think there are parts of the US that may have wild camels as well.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay. So, no, they don't. There's like our biggest predator is the dingo. Well, a dingo is the size of a medium-sized dog. There's no way a dingo can hurt a camel.
No, because they're strong animals.
Even a baby camel could just sit on it, and that would be the end of the dingo.
Yeah.
We've got that, you know, like when camels die, there's plenty of things that'll eat them. But other than that, they we regularly have people that get a group of camels and go completely across Australia from east to west or west to east, like, you know, 4 or 8 camels. Several women have done it by themselves. And it's very impressive because the camels apparently are very cooperative.
They
don't need a lot of coercion. They're a little bit, they've got personality, so they're a little bit difficult to deal with sometimes. But I was only last week, I was listening to a woman who had gone completely across Australia. When things went wrong, she'd turn up at somebody's place with these camels and say, oh, look, I've run out of this, I've run out of that. And people would say, oh, come and stay here for a week. We'll feed you. We'll do, you know, people are out in the middle of nowhere. Any visitor's welcome. And somebody that's doing something really strange is, you know, we Australians like people who do crazy stuff for some reason. So, yeah, so there we got 4 thumb ring materials.
Yeah.
Then he says there is also different types of thumb rings. The first type is half oval.
Yeah.
The second type is like a hoof. The third type is the Kazakh type. The fourth type is duck's beak. The fifth one is like a hat resembling a boat. Now, these are funny descriptions.
Yeah.
I think the half oval is something like this.
Yeah.
Because he describes that if you put 2 of them together, it forms the shape of an egg.
Yeah.
So if you think of an oval shape and you cut it diagonally across, you would actually get 2 thumb ring pieces out of it.
Yeah.
I was going to do that to a billiard ball, actually. But I haven't got around to it because I have worked out how you hold the billiard ball still while you saw it through it, but these are antique ones that were made in the 19th century, so I'm a little bit cautious. He does say, you know, this is made in a way that if 2 thumb protectors of this type are placed next to each other, where the head of each is placed next to the bottom of the other, they resemble an egg. This type should be carved in a way so that the breast remains empty, by which he means here. So he's saying that the inside should be scooped out so that your thumb fits in it and is supported. So it's not supposed to be big and bulky. The rims should be round so that it does not ruin the bowstring of the bow. Then he says, this happens due to a lack of knowledge. The inside of the thumb ring should be empty so the thumb is not stifled. And this is, you probably picked up put on rings, they fit on quite well, but they just don't sit right. Yeah. And he also said it should be a bit loose so it could be taken off. For the sake of the bow, the thumb ring was invented. Notice it's not for the sake of the archer.
Yeah.
Because the thumb ring's advantages for the bow are the single point of release, the less wobble in the release. So with 3 fingers, the string can come off that way, it can come off that way, the middle finger can drag. There's all kinds of things that can go wrong. I mean, you know, a person that's been practicing for a few weeks doesn't do that. But if you went into battle and all of a sudden your life is threatened, you may not actually do things perfectly. So things may go wrong. The second chapter is one of the best because it's 2 lines long. It says, about shooting the earth arrow. Now, we determine that earth, the word they're using is haki. In Ottoman archery, there is an arrow called heki, which is the Osmanli transliteration. In Osmanli, the KH becomes in modern Turkish an H. This was one of those ones where the target is small at a long distance of 250 steps. We did a calculation on this. He actually said the steps of a pregnant woman. I couldn't find one who was willing to walk 250 steps, so we could measure it. So we're guessing it's around about 190 meters. It's not a short distance, put it that way.
But why does he make such a statement, such a comparison? I don't understand.
Well, I'm guessing that there may have been like a idiom or something.
Yeah.
That compared a particular measurement to that, and he's just spelt it out. There's bits and pieces in this that make you think that he's talking the same language, but there are parts of it that are very localized to where he's living at the time. So he said a layer of dust is sprinkled on the target to puff up when it's hit. And this may explain what earth arrow, tiri haki, or heki oktu, or whatever. Oku, sorry, not oktu. Heki oku. What they probably are, you were shooting at such a long distance that you physically couldn't see the arrow in the target. 190 meters, small thin arrow, you can't see it in the target. They didn't have spotting scopes.
Of course.
Like modern artists.
Yeah.
So the answer to that was you get really fine dust and you spread it on the top of the target. So when the target's hit, the vibration shakes the dust off and you see a puff of dust.
Yeah.
It's the equivalent of having a little LED light that flashes whenever it hears the arrow hit. Or the little microphones they have in Korean archery, because their target distance is 140 meters. Again, you might not even hear the arrow hit the target board.
Yeah.
But they have a microphone on the target board, which is connected to a loudspeaker at the shooting area. So whenever an arrow hits, you hear the click when the arrow hits. So this is a similar kind of thing done without electronics. So the third chapter, that was it. That was all that was in that chapter. It's a very small chapter.
I mean, he was not very well versed in academic writing just to make not such a short chapter, right?
My guess is that all of these chapter headings were probably inserted afterwards.
Yeah.
And maybe he intended to write more, because later on, there's much more about these earth arrows.
Yeah.
It's possible that was meant to go after this chapter heading, but he never got around to revising it. So it's all over the place. Then he says about shooting the flight archery arrow. So these chapters are speaking about shooting specific arrows. They're not speaking about classes of archery. So it's like he wrote notes about all the important things, and maybe he was going to go back and reorganize it, but he didn't. The bow for doing this should have short bow arms. It is 13 and a half fists long. Now, this is a problem, because we don't know when they give bow lengths what they're really talking about. And this is true for Ottoman sources as well. When they're talking about arrow length, an arrow is a straight object, so the length is that. But if you get out a museum catalogue and it has a reflex composite bow in it and there's a measurement, it is almost invariably the width across the curve, which is useless because the bow moves. You string it, you put it down, that curve is bigger or smaller. So it's a totally meaningless thing. It's okay if you're a museum curator, because your bow's never going to be shot. So it's never going to change shape. But in reality, when you measure a bow, you should measure it from knock to knock along the edge. And I don't think that's what they're talking about here, but I don't know. We worked out some of these. I'm trying to wake my computer up. I know why. I'm not plugged into the power in here, because this is not where I use my computer. I just brought it in for the purposes of being able to look up things. So a fist is roughly 3.75 centimeters. So therefore, if I find a calculator here, I used to be able to do this in my head when I was younger. I still can, but I'm too lazy. So 13 and a half fists long would be 13.5 times 3.75, which is, see, that's that long. That's 50 and 2/3 of a centimeter. There is no functional bow that long unless it's for a crossbow. Yeah. So this has to be a measurement that we don't understand.
Yeah.
I look at this, unless I've done it wrong, maybe I've done it wrong. Maybe I've done it in inches, in which case 50 inches is a good size. Let me check on the text. This is terrible. Because it's 75 centimeters. So wait a minute. I brought a fist with me.
That's right.
Yeah, no, that was inches. So that's actually right. On me, my fist is roughly 8.5 centimeters, mm-hmm. which is 3.25 inches. And, you know, I don't have big hands. Though, weirdly enough, my hands are the right size for a lot of thumb rings, so maybe my hands are the same size as the people at the time. So we're looking at about 50 inches. That's a reasonable size for a bow. It's a bit long for a Turkish flight bow, for instance, but it's not so long that it'd be a problem. It's like, let me do this in its proper thing and go back and have a look at this. So we'll go 13.5 times, we'll just call it 8 to round it.
Yeah.
So that's 108 centimeters. That's around a flight bow size. So maybe he is talking about round the curve of the bow, in which case this is really useful. The bow used for flight archery is stronger than the bow used to shoot the earth arrow. Now, flight archery bows are made to the maximum strength that you can draw, because the whole point of it is not to shoot 100 arrows. It's to shoot one arrow further than anybody else. And therefore, there's a round, like you might have 5 or 6 arrows in a round, but it's the furthest arrow that counts. All the others are just wasted. So therefore, the first arrow, you're basically warming up. The second arrow, you're probably about right. Third arrow, it should be your best, if you're lucky. Fourth arrow, the bow's getting tired. And, you know, it's a real, with composite, Hornets and composite bows, it's a really, you want to get in fast, get it done. You want to have the most powerful bow you can have. The earth arrows, you're shooting at a target. So you want to have a bow you can control. And going back to what they said before, shoot a bow that's less powerful than you are, but not in flight shooting. Shoot the bow you can. There are problems, like if you're shooting Turkish style with a zipper, you've got to shoot a bow that you can hold your wrist in the right position.
I've
found with some bows that I would get to here and my wrist would start to turn up. So in the end, my zipper's pointing straight up and down, because physically I wasn't strong enough to hold it down.
Yeah.
And so therefore, you know, like, you've got to have a bow you can control, but it must be the most powerful bow you can control.
Yeah.
Then he says they string it. This is the flight bow, with a narrow bowstring made of silk. This is exactly what they did in Turkey too. In contrast to the Kazakh style, the Mizai style is a better way to put the string on the bow. This could relate to the knots in the bowstring, or it actually could relate to thumb ring types. Because the Mirza style, Mizai, this is the princely style, and that's mentioned in Mubarak Shah.
Yeah, it is.
So that's a name for a style. Whether or not it's the style they're using is a different matter. I mean, the name could have survived, but the style's different. And then it says, there's no difference in the type of bowstring used for the string of the bow of the earth arrow and the string of the bow for flight shooting. It should be twisted and tightened that hard that if they unstring the bowstring behaves rigid like a piece of wood. Now, a normal silk bowstring, I've got one somewhere around here, but is as floppy and as wobbly as you could possibly imagine. Yeah. The only way I've ever managed to make one stiff is to do what the Chinese do, which is run serving up the whole length of the bow string. That compresses the fibers, makes a rigid, I mean, it is like a stick. And because it's the fibers are under compression from the serving, it acts, so it's not as springy. so that you, from measured shots, and this was done 30 years ago, so I don't know if it's reasonable, but from measured shots, these very hard bowstrings shoot faster from the same bow than even a bowstring that weighs less, because they act like rigid levers. They're bent in the middle. They don't have that, well, I do probably, but you can't see it. So I don't know. That might be what he's talking about, or he might be talking about putting so much wax on it that it's stiff. But if you do that, that's extra weight for a flight bowstring. That's not a good plan. The length of the flight arrow, the flight archery arrow should be 9.5 fists, and it's fleshed with vulture feathers, and each is 3 fingers long. Yeah. So that's quite short. Later on, when he talks about the earth arrow again, I think he talks about 9 fingers long for the fletching. So yeah, it's about 1/3 of the regular fletching. So 9.5 fists, let's go and mess this up again, is 9.5 times 8 centimeters. And that gives us 76. Sorry, I've got a steam train going past.
Oh, right.
That's what that noise was. It happens occasionally, not very often. So that's that for me. 5'5" is a draw to this. It's about 29 inches. We can work out what it is. We'll just do a little division here. 29.9, so it's almost 30 inches, which is, weirdly enough, the recommended size for a target arrow in Taibuka in Saracen Archery.
Yeah.
When I was younger, I could pull that far. I was still the same height. It's just that my shoulders would stretch out better. So I think that's totally reasonable. He does say for other arrows, more regular arrows, they're a little bit shorter than that, which would give you a more comfortable draw to the ear. The shaft of the arrow is very light, narrow and hard, so that the wind does not shake it. So he was aware of air resistance. I mean, that's what it means. Its arrow nock should not be wide, because he says that the string is thin earlier.
Yeah.
When drawing this bow, they should divide the sky in three. Two parts should be left behind the head, and one part should be in front of the head. So if you've got 180 degrees divided by three, that's shooting at a 60 degree angle, which is a little bit too steep for efficient flight shooting. But, you know, who knows? That might have been what they did. It might have been appropriate for their area and the types of arrow and bow that you're using. Normally, you'd be going for somewhere below 45 degrees, say about 42.5, but experience suggests that the difference in a couple of degrees makes less difference than your release. So it to be totally focused on the angle you're shooting, as long as it's within a couple of degrees, is a waste of effort, because you're gonna, by thinking too hard about that, you're gonna probably slow your release down or do something else that's not very useful. He should stay strong. Well, that's true. You've got to be strong to shoot a flight bow. One hand is in the same line with the shoulder. Now, this can be very confusing. I will read it out and then I'll explain what I think he's talking about. Of the archer, and the right hand starts below the level of the right armpit. They keep the left hand very strong so it does not fall back. Okay. If you are shooting at an angle, there's two ways you can do it. You can just raise your arm at an angle to your shoulders, or you can raise your whole shoulder structure at an angle to the ground. Now, if you raise your arm, you throw your arm out of alignment with the shoulder socket, which means the weight of the bow that you can draw that way isn't as great as it would be if you kept your shoulders in line. So if your waist is supple, you just bend at the waist. Your spine curves, but your shoulders are in a straight line with your arm. I think that's what he's talking about. That's what you normally see flight archers do, unless they're shooting light bows. And the right hand below the level of the right armpit. Well, that's the level of the right armpit. When you do that, if you drew a straight line across there, that hand would be below the right armpit if you were standing square. I don't know. That works. It may, in fact, be totally wrong because we're you can't rely on, there aren't very many paintings of people doing flight archery. There's lots of paintings of people shooting straight. There are paintings of people shooting up at the popinjay target.
Yeah.
And they not normally rock back. But then again, it's what the painter thought was appropriate, not necessarily what people really did. Yeah. They keep the left hand very strong so that it does not fall back. I think they mean that, because that's what happened to me. With very strong bows, my left hand fell back on itself and I started to support the bow with the base of the hand instead of the web and the finger and thumb. They should take one step back with the arrow as if the bow is pulling them back. If the bow was pulling them back, it'd actually be pulling them towards the target area, not the other thing. So they wouldn't be taking a step back, they'd be taking a step forward. And a lot of flight archers, when they shoot, shift their weight onto their forward leg to give themselves a little bit of extra impetus. And the last manuscript that we did a thing on was talking about how you stood on the ball of your left foot. You didn't have it flat on the ground, and then you could move your weight forward onto it. Don't know. Interesting. It may be very straightforward, or it may be something we just don't understand. But the last sentence in this chapter is the crucial one. Flight archery requires continuous training. It's because you're training yourself to shoot at a fixed angle without anything to guide you.
Yeah.
So you've got to do a lot of practice with somebody telling you, yeah, you're at the right angle now. So your body memorizes where it should be. It's not easy. Now, having had these three chapters, which are essentially talking about arrows, the fourth chapter, it's about the different types of arrows, and now it goes into some detail. The first type has an arrow head with four edges. Its arrow head is three fingers long. That's not bad. We can do this in centimeters. That's about 60 millimeters long, 6 centimeters long. It's quite a big arrowhead. I mean, here's an arrowhead laying around. It is, about 58.
Yeah.
So that's the kind of arrowhead is. Not that shape, but that's the kind. The arrow tang is four fingers long. And it's not hardened, so four fingers. So the arrow head is just a little bit shorter than the arrow tang. Bear in mind, he's probably talking all the way through this about reed arrows, which are hollow. So the tang fits into the arrow. Normally in India, at least, and possibly in Persia, they fill the end of the arrow with hot pitch, and then they stick the tang of the arrow into that, and then they bind the whole thing with sinew, which the pitch cools and goes rigid like an epoxy cement or something like that. It makes it, if your arrowhead gets bent or anything, it makes it really easy. You just heat the end of the arrow and you can straighten it out and get it all lined up again. It's a very good system. And there were lots of tropical trees in India and certain trees in Iran as well that produced excellent resin for this kind of thing.
Yeah.
He says, the arrow tang is four fingers long and is not hardened. Now, this is really important. If this part of your arrow head is hard, look how much thinner it is than the rest of the arrowhead. It's going to snap. You want it soft. I mean, it's like you don't want the tang of your sword to be really hard either.
Yeah, of course. It will break. Yeah.
It's going to break. So, but this is important because A, it means that they knew all about hardening, and B, they knew where not to harden.
Yeah.
So it shows, different things. It says this can be shot at bill and tabe. Now, bill is a word for a spade.
Yeah.
There's Indian arrowheads, they call them bilek, little spades. and they're a broadhead shaped like a spade. But shooting at a bill, because as this goes on, it starts to talk about penetration tests. There is a iron target that was used in Turkey to demonstrate the penetrative power of arrowheads and bows. And it is roughly that shape. It's actually, I think, part of a plow or something like that. But it's roughly that shape. So I think we're talking about the same thing. This is a quite a solid four-sided bodkin point designed specifically for penetration. He mentioned that the there are three layers of sinew around the shaft where the tang goes in. So this is a really solid arrowhead. It's really strong. Then he says there are two types of arrowhead for shooting at a shield. The first type is an arrow with a rounded iron arrowhead. Half of the arrowhead should be hollow. It is not shot very hard like a broadhead arrow, which he then calls bill. So yeah, we got problems here. My guess is he could be talking about a socketed arrow.
Yeah.
In the Middle East and Iran and India, socketed arrows were always considered to be weaker because they would snap off the shaft. The exact reverse is true in Europe, where they think that socketed arrows are stronger. But, you know, it just depends on how they're made. But it could be something else. Half of the arrowhead should be hollow. Could mean it is like these billet arrowheads, where they actually have a cutaway portion. So they've got a blade in the front, and then the back part is cut away.
Yeah.
Not enough information. The second type is the atku. Now, he says it's a Turkic word and it means going. I couldn't find a Turkic word like that. Doesn't mean there isn't one, just means I couldn't find it. I've got an old Turkish dictionary, like a pre-13th century Turkish dictionary. And you would think that if it was an old word, it would have been in there, but it's not. But anyway, bearing in mind, if he's in Delhi, by this stage, assuming that it is like 1700 or 1770, by this stage, the Mughal emperors weren't talking Chagatai Turkish at home anymore. What they used to do is talk Turkic at home and Persian at court.
Yeah.
But there's a possibility that Turkic loanwords had got into the language that are not the same as the Turkic loanwords that got into Farsi in Iran, because different groups, different dialect groups, like Chagatai, I don't think we're talking the kind of Western branch like Osmanli and Azerbaijani and Turkmeni. I think they were talking a different type of Turkic language.
Yeah.
And their name comes from Chinggis Khan's second son, Chagatai Khan. They're not Mongols, they were part of a Mongol state, but they're basically Turkic people. And it says, its arrowhead is made of conical staghorn with a length of two fingers. And I could have done it another way, it would have been very rude. Its tang is made of olive wood with a length of three fingers. Now, what we're talking about is an antler head with a hole drilled in it, with a piece of olive wood. Is really strong, I might add. It's very, very strong. There's some Turkish daggers from the 16th century around with olive wood handles.
Yeah.
Of course, it was so strong.